Hi. Today in this session we are going to discuss about Fourier transform. So by the time transform or an integral transform, we represent to a transformation which produces a new function that depends on a different variable other than the original function, and which is represented in the form of an integral. You may be familiar with the concept of Laplace transforms, and Laplace transform is the most important and most useful tool in solving differential equations and approaching in many engineering problems. Then, while we're considering the engineering applications, Fourier transforms may be the second most important transforms. And in this session, we are going to discuss about Fourier transforms. So we just start with the concept of Fourier transform first, and then we define the concept of Fourier sine transform and Fourier cosine transform, and after that we define the concept of we go through a number of problems which can be addressed using Fourier transform. So first we define the Fourier transform. Let's consider a function f of x. So a function with independent variable x. Then the Fourier transform of f of x, usually represented by f hat of x. That's the common representation. F hat of omega. That's the new variable. That's equal to 1 by root 2 pi into integral minus infinity to plus infinity f of x into e raised minus I omega x dx. That's the Fourier transform of f of x. And if f of x has the Fourier transform of f hat omega, then the value of f of x can be calculated as f of x is equal to 1 by root 2 pi integral minus infinity to plus infinity f hat omega into e raised I omega x dx. So that's the definition of transform of a function and the inverse Fourier transform of f hat omega. So observe one thing: the original function f of x is f of x has an independent variable x, and the transform has an independent variable omega. So that's the nature of an integral transform. Anyway, you are familiar with the same in Laplace, in the case of Laplace transforms. So in some cases, we represent the Fourier transform using the capital F, script F in some cases. Capital F of F is equal to F hat. So that's another representation which we are going to use in Fourier transforms. Anyway, this is the definition of Fourier transform and its inverse transform. Now, if Fourier transform, this Fourier transform exists when f of x is a piecewise continuous function on every finite interval, and when f of x is absolutely integrable, f of x is absolutely integrable on the x-axis. That is, the absolute value of f of x, if we integrate the absolute value of f of x in between say minus infinity to plus infinity, then the integral should exist and should be a finite value. that case, we can say that it is integrable, absolutely integrable. So that's how we define the concept of Fourier transform. Now, if we consider this transformation, then e raised I omega x or e raised I minus I omega x can be written as e raised I omega x is equal to cos omega x plus I into sin omega x. And e raised minus I omega x is nothing but cos omega x minus I sin omega x. So we can obtain two different transforms other than this Fourier transform, inspired from the same definition, and they are Fourier sine transform and Fourier cosine transform. The Fourier cosine transform is nothing but integral 0 to infinity f of x into cos omega x dx, and here we just add another term, 1 by 2 by pi, root of 2 by pi, and this is the Fourier cosine transform of the function. And in a similar way, integral 0 to infinity root of 2 by pi into integral 0 to infinity f of x into sine omega x d omega, not d omega, dx, will give the Fourier sine transform of the function. And we can define the inverse transform of the same as f of x is equal to f of x is equal to root of 2 by pi into integral 0 to infinity f Fourier transform of the function, Fourier cosine transform of the function into cos omega x into d omega. And the original function is also given by 2 by pi into integral 0 to infinity the Fourier sine transform of the function into sine omega x into d omega. This is the inverse transform. And the above one is the Fourier sine transform and Fourier cosine transform. This is Fourier cosine transform, and this is Fourier sine transform. And one more thing which we would like to observe is that when we consider the Fourier transform of a function f of x is equal to integral minus infinity to plus infinity 1 by root 2 pi f of x into the Fourier transform of the function f of x into e raised minus I omega x dx is equal to 1 by root 2 pi into integral minus infinity to plus infinity f of x into e raised I omega x can be written as cos omega x plus I into sin omega x then dx, which can be written as 1 by root 2 pi into integral minus infinity to plus infinity f of x into cos omega x plus 1 by root 2 pi into this I can also take an outside in the integral minus infinity to plus infinity f of x into sine omega x dx. So that's the representation of a Fourier series for a transform of the given function. Now, if our function f of x is an odd function, if f of x is an odd function, that is f of minus x is equal to minus of f of x, then we know that the function cos x, cos minus x is equal to, cos minus x is equal to cos x, and sine minus x is equal to minus of sine x. So this cos x is an even function and sine x is an odd function. So f of minus x is equal to f of x, then the function is an even function. Now, if we consider the product of two even function, it is an even function, and the product of another two odd function is an even function, and even function into odd function become an odd function. So these are some preliminary concepts. Now, another thing is, if you have an integral like integral minus infinity to plus infinity, or if there are two any other values, say minus a to a f of x dx, this is equal to zero if f of x is an odd function, and is equal to 2 times integral 0 to a f of x dx if f of x is even. So that's a result which obtained from the integral calculus. Now, we can use this concept in our Fourier transforms, and what we obtain is f hat omega is equal to 1 by root 2 pi into, so observe here in this representation, if f of x is an odd function, then the first term is again odd function into even function become an odd function, integral from minus infinity to plus infinity become zero, and in the second case f of x is an odd function, sine omega x omega x is an even function, sorry, odd function, so product become an even function, so the second integral become 2 times integral 0 to infinity. And if f of x is an even function, then the first integral f of x into cos omega x is the product become an even function, and here the product become an odd function, so the second integral will vanish. So if you use that idea, then if f of x is an even function, then this one become 2 times integral 0 to infinity f of x into cos omega x dx plus 1 by root 2 pi into sine omega x into cos omega x is an odd function, so its integral is 0 and there is an I value. So this is equal to this 2 and root 2 get cancelled, and what we get is root 2 by pi into integral 0 to infinity f of x into cos omega x dx. And in a similar way, That happens when f of x is an even function. If f of x is an odd function, if f of x is an odd function, then f of x into cos omega x is an odd function, and that integral becomes zero, and the Fourier transform becomes I into root 2 by pi into integral 0 to infinity f of x into sine omega x into dx. So what we have here is an interesting result. If the function is an odd function, then that Fourier transform become equal to the sine transform, and if f of x is an even function, then the Fourier transform become a cosine transform. And there is anyway, there is a difference of this I, and that is because the Fourier transform contains the term e raised to I omega x, and this is a complex quantity, and that is why there is a term I. Anyway, so that's how we can relate the concept of Fourier transforms and Fourier sine transforms and Fourier cosine transforms. So that's a definition part. Now we can have some simple problems in which we illustrate the concept of Fourier transforms and Fourier inverse transform. So let's start with a simple function like f of x is equal to k when 0 less than x less than a and equal to 0 otherwise. So that's a simple function in which the function takes a value k in an interval 0 to a, and after that the function is equal to 0. Now how we can find the Fourier transform? So the Fourier transform is f at omega is equal to 1 by root 2 pi then integral minus infinity to plus infinity f of x into e raised I omega x minus I omega x dx. But actually the function has a non-zero value only in the interval 0 to a. So in interval 0 to a, k into e raised I omega x dx. From 0 to a the value is k, and outside the interval the value is 0. So this is equal to 1 by root 2 pi into integral 0 to k 0 to a k into e raised I omega x dx, which is k is a constant. Integral of e raised I omega x with respect to x is e raised I minus I omega x into this one, in between 0 and a. Now this is equal to 1 by root 2 pi into upper limit k into e raised I a omega minus the lower limit is 0, that is 1, e raised 0 is 1, divided by minus I omega x. So that's equal to this k is a constant, k by root 2 pi, they are constants, and what remains is here we have a minus sign, and if you multiply with that minus sign here, it becomes 1 minus e raised to minus I a omega, and in the denominator we have I omega, not x, I omega. So here in the denominator when we take the integral, it is e raised to I omega x divided by I omega, Okay, so that's the Fourier transform of our function f of x is equal to k. And observe one thing, what we obtain here is a complex valued function, or it's a complex function. So what we can conclude here is that Fourier transform will generate a complex function in general. The function, the output may not be always complex, but in general sense, what we obtain is a complex function. So this is how we calculate the Fourier transform of a function. Now let us have another example. Consider f of x is equal to e raised to minus a x square, where a is a positive number. So in the previous case, we consider a function which is defined only for an interval from 0 to a, and in this case what we consider is a function which is defined for all values in the real number. And here f hat omega is equal to 1 by root 2 pi into integral minus infinity to plus infinity e raised to minus a x square, that is f of x, into e raised to minus I omega x into dx. So that's equal to 1 by root 2 pi into integral minus infinity to plus infinity, we can write it as e raised to minus ax square plus omega x, I omega x dx. Now a square plus I omega x is equal to, if you take an a outside, it become a square plus I omega divided by a omega x by a. And to make it a perfect square, we just add and subtract the half of coefficient of x, that is a into x square into I omega divided by 2 the square minus I omega divided by 2a plus I omega x by a. And that's equal to a into what we have is x square plus I omega divided by 2a the square, a square plus b square, then plus 2ab become I omega x divided by a, 2 and 2 will cancel. Now this one minus I omega divided by 2a, the whole square, a is common. And that's equal to a into the first term is x minus or x plus I omega divided by 2a, the whole square, minus I omega divided by 2a, the square.
And this is equal to, if you multiply with this particular a, what we have is x plus I omega divided by 2a into a. So it is, all the terms are multiplied with a. So there is outside, when we move this a into a square term, but there is root of a. Here we have a root of a and this a cancelled, so we have root of a minus here also we have I omega divided by 2 into root of a, the whole square. So this is say equation number 2 that is substituted in our expression for the Fourier integrals, and that will give the Fourier transform is equal to under root 2 pi into e raised to minus of this thing, that is f of f hat omega is equal to 1 by root 2 pi into integral minus infinity to plus infinity e raised to minus of first time is our root a into x plus I omega divided by 2 into root of a, the all square. Then the next time it's a negative term, so we already have a common negative sign, so it becomes a positive term, positive term. I omega divided by 2 of root a, the all square. And all these things are in exponent, and our integration is with respect to x. And now this is equal to this exponential term can be split into 2, and the second term e raised I omega divided by 2 root a is independent of x, and that term can be taken outside the integral, and it become e raised I omega the whole square, that is I square is minus omega square divided by 2 square is 4 a divided by root of 2 pi into integral minus infinity to plus infinity e to the power minus root of a into x plus I omega divided by 2 into root of a, the whole square, dx. And let us mark it as equation number 3. Now, here let us name the integral here as I. Let it be, this integral be represented by I. Now, let us make a substitution to the term. Say, u is equal to root of ax plus I omega divided by 2 root of a. Let it be u. Then naturally du is equal to root of a dx, or dx can be replaced with 1 by root of a du. And when x is equal to minus infinity, u is also equal to minus infinity. X is equal to minus infinity implies u is equal to minus infinity. And when x is equal to infinity, u is also equal to infinity. So this integral I become, I is the integral which is equal to integral minus infinity to plus infinity e to the power minus of u square into 1 by root of a du. So that 1 by root of a can be taken as a common factor. Now, to evaluate this particular integral, maybe written as equation number 4, to evaluate this integral in equation number 4, we are going to use another trick. So, just we take the product of 1 by root of a integral minus infinity to plus infinity e raised to minus u square du into 1 by root of a into integral minus infinity to plus infinity e raised to minus v square into dv. So the first integral and the second integral are essentially the same, and the first one is equal to I, the second one is also equal to I, so the value is nothing but I square, and that gives this I square is equal to 1 by root a into 1 by root a is 1 by a, then integral minus infinity to plus infinity, since these two integrals are independent, the variation of u and variation of v are independent, so we can write it as integral minus of u square plus v square, we combine them into du dv. So if you consider the xy plane, the x can vary from minus infinity to plus infinity, or u can vary from minus infinity to plus infinity, and v can also vary from minus infinity to plus infinity. Now we transform this integral into the polar coordinates using the transformation x, u is equal to r cos theta and v is equal to r sine theta. And theta varies from 0 to 2 pi, and r varies from 0 to infinity. So as the value of theta varies from 0 to 2 pi and r varies from 0 to theta, the values of r and theta will cover the all UV plane or XY plane. Therefore, this integral become 1 by a into integral. So here we have two integrals, one is u and one is with respect to v. And here we have a double integral in which theta varies from 0 to 2 pi and r varies from 0 to infinity. So r varies from 0 to infinity, theta varies from 0 to 2 pi e to the power minus of u square plus v square is r square, then du dv, that is an area integral, so the transformation is r dr d theta, and this is equal to 1 by a into integral. It varies from 0, theta varies from 0 to 2 pi, then e raised to minus r square r dr d theta. This integral is the derivative of, say, e raised to minus r square. If you differentiate it, what we get is e raised to minus r square into 2r. So if you divide both term by 2, then r dr square is the derivative of 1 by 2 e raised to minus r square, or in other ways, r e raised to minus r square has an integral of 1 by 2 r square. So it is, there is a minus sign also. So it is e raised to minus r square divided by 2 and plus or minus sign in between 0 and infinity d theta. Now that's equal to, this thing is equal to 1 by a, that's a constant, 0 to 2 pi, it is to be integrated, and here the upper bound e raised to minus infinity, that is 0, then minus is also become a minus sign, so plus, the lower bound e raised to 0, that is 1, so this is 1 by 2 d theta. That's equal to 1 by 2a into the middle of d theta is theta in between 0 and 2 pi. So this is equal to upper bound is 2 pi by 2a, lower bound is 0. So it is pi by a. So what we have is I square is equal to pi by a, which implies I equal to root of pi by a. Let it be equation number, say, I think this is 5. Now, we can substitute this in our expression for Fourier series, for a transform, is obtained here. This integral is I, and that is replaced with pi by a. So it is Fourier transform is e raised to minus omega square root by 4 a. If at omega is equal to e raised to minus omega square divided by 4 a, then we have 1 by root 2 pi into the value of I, that is root of pi by a. That's equal to this root pi and root pi will get cancelled, and what we have is 1 by root of 2 into here we have root of a, so root 2 a into pi already get cancelled, and what remains is e raised minus omega square divided by 4a. So this is our Fourier transform of the given function. So this is not a complex function, it's a real valued function. 1 by root 2a e raised to minus omega square into 4a is the Fourier transform of e raised to minus a x square. This is our given function and this is our Fourier transform. So that's how we calculate the Fourier transform of a function. The second one is comparatively a tricky one, and the first one is a straightforward one. Now, we can have some problems on Fourier sine transform and Fourier cosine transform in our next session, and we may have some examples using Fourier transforms, and after that we will go through the concept of Fourier integrals. So that's all we have to go through in our coming sessions. So we will have at least 1, 2, 3, 4 sessions related to Fourier transforms and Fourier integrals. So let us meet in our next session. For the time being, thank you.